Hello people, today we are going to start our new topic, that is human relation theory, in which we will be covering the human relation theory or the contribution of Elton Mayo. So let's get started. Human relation theory. So human relation theory came into existence in 1930s as a reaction to classical approach to organization. Classical thinkers like Taylor, Fayol, Gulick, Orwick and Weber stressed the formal structure of organization and neglected the role of human element in the organization. Plus, the classical organization theory has found attention on physiological and mechanical aspect of organizational functioning. So, this critical failure of classical approach gave rise to the human relation approach. The term human relation refers to reaction between workers and employers which are not regulated by legal norms. The human relation concept is concerned with division concern method of ideological organizations of workers in the factory. Many socio-economic factors influence the emergence of theory and practice of human relation, like economic depression, capital incentive industry, reaction to Taylorism and classical antagonism. Human relation theory is also known as humanistic theory, socio-economic theory and neo-economic theory. And there are other writers who contributed to the growth of human relation theory are F. J. Rolfsberg, William J. Dixon, T. North Whitehead, W. Lloyd, E. Warner, and L. J. Henderson. Now we will see what are the contribution of Elton Mayo for this theory. So Elton Mayo is regarded as the father of human relation theory. He emphasized the physiological, physical, economic, social and psychological aspect of human behavior. He called this method as clinical method. His main hypothesis is that relation between employer and employees should be humanistic, not mechanistic. Employees and workers deserve to be treated as individual with dignity and self-respect rather than a factor of production or interchangeable element of the production system. He looked upon industrial organization and physiological system with primary emphasis on human resource, their behavior and welfare, need and satisfaction, interaction and cooperation. So because in classical thinker or classical organization or classical theory mein jo humans ki baat, jo employees ki baat ya jo वर्कर्स की बात होती थी वो सिर्फ एक तरीके से मैकेनिस्टिक उसमें व्यू में ही होती थी, उनको एज अ ह्यूमन नहीं ट्रीट किया जाता था. इन ह्यूमन रिलेशन थ्योरी वर्कर्स को या एम्प्लॉयज को एज अ ह्यूमन ट्रीट किया गया है. सो हिज मेजर मीन्स एल्टन मेयोज मेजर वर्क आर फर्स्ट अ ह्यूमन प्रॉब्लम, द ह्यूमन प्रॉब्लम ऑफ एन इंडस्ट्रियल सिविलाइजेशन इन 1933, द सोशल प्रॉब्लम ऑफ एन इंडस्ट्रियल सिविलाइजेशन इन 1945 and the political problem of an industrial civilization in 1947. Now we will see the three elements of human relation theory. So first is the individual. The theory recognized the importance of emotions and perceptions of individuals. The level of workers' production and organizational output is determined by the human relation at work rather than the physical and economic condition of work. Second is the informal organization. Human relation theory emphasizes the informal organization. Thus, human relation theory highlights the effects of a work group on workers' motivation, satisfaction, and productivity. And third is participative management. The human relation theory advocates the style of participative management, that is participation of workers in decision making with regard to their work conditions. The manager should consult the work group and the informal leader before introducing a change of work schedule. Now we will talk about Hawthorne studies, which was conducted by Elton Mayo from 1924 to 1932. So Mayo started the most intensive human relation study known as Hawthorne study, conducted at Hawthorne plant of Western Electrical Company at Hawthorne near Chicago, USA from 1924 to 1932, which was employed 25,000 workers at that time. The purpose of experiment was to measure the effect of improved illumination and psychological and social problem of industrial workers. And this study was conducted in four phases. First is illumination experiment from 1924 to 1927. It is to determine the effect of different level of illumination on workers' productivity. So at this, the physical environment in which the girl were working was established to acclimatize them to room temperature, humidity, etc. Then slowly the condition of work were changed to mark the effect of this change on the output. The researchers observed the group and kept accurate record of production. Second is relay assembly test room experiment from in 1927. It is to observe the effect of various changes in working condition on the workers' output and morale. So at this stage, five girls were organized in a second relay assembly test room identical to first one. This very experiment convinced the researchers that neither wage incentives alone nor change in physical condition could help in production increase. The explanation was that girls experienced a tremendous increase in work satisfaction because they had great freedom in work environment. Third is mass interviewing program. From 1928 to 1931, it is to explore the employees' feeling by talking to them. So in this, interviews were conducted of the employees. The job of interviewers was to listen attentively and display a real interest in everything employees said without suggesting an answer. The impact was that employees appreciated being recognized, having equal voice with management on organizational dynamics, and realized that their free experience had improved the condition. So this brought change in attitude of supervisors because of realization that the researchers have access to his method of supervision and views of the workers. And last is bank wiring experiment from 1931 to 1932. It is to understand better how the norm or that control each member output were established by the workers' social group. So this experiment was conducted in a non-experimental setting, that is, it was conducted in a natural setting. The result in this case were different from the relay room experiment. So Mayo diagnosed the problem as one of lack of adequate rest, which was causing fatigue to the workers. He introduced rest period. He introduced new formula to earn bonus. If the worker were to produce more than a certain percentage, they would earn bonus proportionate to their extra production. Rest periods and new bonus, the workers were highly motivated and happy. Now we will see the conclusion of Hawthorne's study. So first is the social and psychological factor at the workplace and not the physical condition of work determine the employees' morale and output. The organization is a social system. Non-economic rewards and sanctions significantly affect the workers' behavior, morale, and output. Workers are not inert or isolated, unrelated individuals. Rather, they are social animals. Division of labor strictly on specialization is not necessarily the most efficient approach. The workers have a tendency to form small groups. The production norm and behavioral pattern are set by such groups. Workers react to management as members of the informal work groups rather as an individual. And leadership, style of supervision, communication and participation plays a certain role in workers' behavior, satisfaction and productivity. But after all this, this very organization or this approach has some criticism. So they are: workers react positively as they give their best when they knew that they were being observed. Neglected, they neglected the nature of work and instead focused on interpersonal relations. They concentrated more on member of the organization and neglected its work and purpose. It ignores the environmental factor of workers' attitude and behavior. Human relation theory could not explore the multidimensional phenomena of human motivation completely, and Marxist says that Mayonism is a new technique to exploit workers as it has de-emphasized economic factors. Now we will see what are the contribution or what is the contribution of this theory towards the public administration. So Mayo's contribution to administrative thought has been phenomenal. His impact has been tremendous both on management and on academics. At a time when management was developing new techniques and emphasizes on system as the way to better management, Mayo was questioning the basis on which industrial performance rested. Human relation promoted a particular vision of human nature in organization setting. It urged cooperation over competition and interdependency over individualism. If we talk about Hawthorne experiment, so for Hawthorne experiment, his major findings are, first, the level of production is determined by group norms, not by the ability of workers. Second, it is non-economic reward and sanction which affect employees' behavior and limits the efficiency of economic incentives. And third is workers act not as isolated individuals but member of groups. The study shows that in addition to the formal organization, there is an informal organization. So in brief, we can say that Hawthorne study are still treated as a historic landmark in administrative thoughts. Right, so this is for today's video. In the next video, we will be covering similarities and differences between the classical thinker and human relation thinker, that is Mayo, Alton Mayo, and Taylorism ideology. So till then, do like and share the video, subscribe the channel, press the bell icon for further content, and comment down below if you have any query related to this topic or any topic we have done till now. That's it for today. Thank you.